So our familiar friend, Reverend Wilson, will be giving the sermon. So, is this on?
I think you can be closer.
Is this on?
Yes, you just need to be closer to it, I think.
No, it's not on.
Oh.
Yes, now.
It is? No. I'm not sure how to turn it.
Do you want me to?
Yeah. It's not obvious.
Let's see. Oh.
Good morning.
Oh, great.
Only get to use this about every 2 months or something. So unless there's any announcements from, nobody is giving me any extra announcements. Okay. I guess we'll begin our worship with.
Let's stand.
Yeah, want to stand?
We're at the intro.
That's right. Like to stand and we'll either follow along on the screen or in your bulletin the call to worship. The Lord is merciful and gracious,
slow to anger and abounding in love.
In the name of Christ, be reconciled to God.
This is our day of our salvation.
Let us worship God. This morning, the adoration prayer is actually attributed to St. Francis of Assisi. I don't have the original, so this is a paraphrase of it. All praise be yours, my Lord, through all that you have made. And my first Lord, brother, son, who brings the day, how beautiful is he, how radiant in all his splendor. Of you, Most High, he bears the likeness. All praise be yours, my Lord, through sister, moon, and stars. In the heavens you have made them, bright and precious and fair. All praise be yours, my Lord, through brothers, wind, and air. All praise be yours, my Lord, through sister, water, so useful, lowly, precious, and pure. All praise be yours, my Lord, through brother, fire, through whom you brighten up the night. All praise be yours, my Lord, through sister, earth, our mother, who feeds us and produces various fruits with colored flowers and herbs. Praise and bless my Lord and give him thanks and serve him with great humility.
Thank you.
to join in the prayer of confession. Lord, you know the ways of good and evil. You know the things that tempt us and the things that give us life. You know our nakedness and you know our sin. We confess that we have disobeyed your word, denying your providence and care, and relying on our own cleverness. Have mercy on us, we pray. Cover us with your grace. Feed us with the bread of life, and recreate us in your image, through Jesus Christ, our Savior. Amen.
Sisters and brothers of faith, happy are those whose sin is forgiven. Be glad in the Lord and shout for joy in Jesus Christ. We are forgiven.
Thanks be to God.
The peace of Christ be with you.
So this morning's scripture reading is from Genesis 3, 1 to 7. In the Pew Bible, it's on page 4. Easy to find. Now the serpent was more crafty than any of the wild animals the Lord God had made. He said to the woman, "Did God really say, 'You must not eat from any tree in the garden?'" The woman said to the serpent, "We may eat fruit from the trees in the garden, but God did say, 'You must not eat from the fruit of the tree that is in the middle of the garden, and you must not touch it, or you will die.'" "You will not surely die," the serpent said to the woman, "for God knows that when you eat of it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil." When the woman saw that the fruit of the tree was good for food and pleasing to the eye, and also desirable for gaining wisdom, she took some of it and ate it. She also gave some of it to her husband who was with her, and he ate it. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they realized they were naked. So they sewed fig leaves together and made coverings for themselves.
Thank you, choir. Turn with me now to Matthew, the 4th chapter, and the 1 to 11, it's on page 1499 in your pew Bible. And this is a familiar text. You've heard it thousands of times, perhaps. Jesus had been baptized. And when he was baptized, the Holy Spirit came upon him in all of its fullness, and a voice from heaven said, "Behold, this is my beloved Son. Listen to him." And then Mark says that the Spirit thrust Jesus into the wilderness. Nonetheless, this Holy Spirit was with him. As we read then from Matthew's Gospel, "Then Jesus was led up by the Spirit into the wilderness to be tempted by the devil. He fasted 40 days and 40 nights, and afterwards he was famished. The tempter came and said to him, 'If you are the Son of God, command these stones to become loaves of bread.' But he answered, 'It is written, one does not live by bread alone, but by every word that comes from the mouth of God.' Then the devil took him to the holy city and placed him high on the pinnacle of the temple, saying to him, 'If you are the Son of God, throw yourself down, for it is written, he will command his angels concerning you, and on their hands they will bear you up, so that you will not dash your foot against a stone.' Jesus said to him again, 'It is written, do not put the Lord your God to the test.' Again, the devil took him to a very high mountain and showed him all the kingdoms of this world and their splendor. And he said to him, 'All these I will give you, if you will fall down and worship me.' Jesus said to him, 'Away with you, Satan, for it is written, worship the Lord your God and serve only him.' Then the devil left him, and suddenly angels came and waited on him." The word of the Lord for the people of the Lord. Praise be to God. Let us pray. Lord, we come before you this morning thanking you for a word, thanking you for the word made flesh, thanking you for Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. May through the power of the Holy Spirit, that word be revealed and be very present with us, we pray. Amen. I want to speak to you today about three words. Did God say? ? Did God say? Now, I'm not one of those persons who is fond of snakes. Or anybody here fond of snakes? Last summer in August, I was mowing the grass, and I saw this brown thing low in the grass moving. I wasn't quite sure, but I thought it might have been a snake, but not until I went close to it did I realize that indeed it was a 4-foot-long snake. It tried to get away from me, but I was a bit faster, so suddenly when it saw me, it curled up as if it were going to strike me. I immediately could tell that it was not a venomous snake, and I knew that it was a garter snake, quite harmless. Nonetheless, the snake did not know that I was not going to be harmful to it. It was angry. As I backed off the mower and took off, the snake just slithered off in the high grass. I got to thinking about snakes. I had a member of my last congregation who had a boa constrictor. And every way, you know, as you're greeting the congregation and they're leaving after worship, you shake their hand. And he said one day to me, "Do you know what pet I have?" And I said, "I have no idea." He said, I have a 7-foot boa constrictor. I love it. I feed it white mice. They're frozen in the refrigerator. So, very, I'm thinking to myself, yikes. Well, I kept asking him as he left church every Sunday, how indeed is your friend, and he had a name for it, I don't remember what it was, whether it was boa or not, I don't know. But he said, I asked him, and I would ask him, he said, oh, he's doing fine, he's eating the mice, he's healthy, he's growing. And then one Sunday, he came into church with marks on both hands, and I said, what's up? He said, well, the snake thought that I was a white mice and began to constrict around me and want to eat me. I had to call 911 to get the snake off of me. I said, I hope he got rid of the snake. He said, no, not yet, it's still my pet. I don't know whatever happened. The man might be still feeding it white mice. But as I say, I am not fond of snakes, but today at the heart of our story is a snake. Genesis tells us that indeed it was a serpent. So I looked up the word serpent and it said a very big snake, a very big snake, perhaps a boa constrictor or a Burmese python. And the snake was kind of unique. This snake could talk. Have you ever heard of a talking snake? The snake was in the center of the garden, perhaps entwined among the branches. And as Eve was passing by, she knew full well she was not to touch that forbidden fruit. God had made it abundantly clear. The moment you touch that, you shall die. But the serpent, scripture says, was cunning, and he had a way with words. He was a smooth talker. And he said to Eve, did God really say you can't eat this luscious, beautiful fruit? Can you imagine how tasty and delicious this must be? Here was Eve's mistake. She began to be wooed and seduced and warmed up to that serpent, and she began to converse with it. Well, yes, God did say that, and he did say that I would die. We would die if I ate it. Oh, said the serpent, do you believe that? God knows you won't die. Now, isn't it interesting? A talking snake who knows God and speaks for God. Interesting. So Eve could not resist. She saw it was appealing for the eye, it was attractive, and she was wooed into wanting to taste this delicious fruit. All the time, she was ignoring what God had said. But did God really say you shouldn't eat this fruit? Think about it, Eve, said the serpent. It's the nicest tree in all of the garden. That's why it's in the center of the garden. For God knows when you eat it, you will not die. And so she took the largest and firmest of the fruit off the tree, and she took a healthy big bite with juice spreading out as though it were a Macintosh apple. And she said, wow, this tastes good. I'm going to have to share some with Adam. Hey, Adam, come here. Come here. Taste this delicious fruit. Notice, Adam never said, did God say you should not eat that, not touch that? You know, we talk about men being the stronger of the sexes. Well, that's not true because After all, we know that Adam fell rather quickly after Eve said, take a bite, this is good. That very moment, the earth shook, the universe was torn apart, and man fell. Their eyes were open. They realized they were naked. These were things that they didn't know before. They had everything given to them. It was a wonderful, beautiful garden with no weeds. I wish God would come around my garden. But no weeds, beautiful dahlias and luscious tomatoes, bright red, juicy. But they were not content. They were dissatisfied. And Satan had said, the serpent had said, if you eat this, you will be as God. You can become God. Just take a bite. Did God really say you couldn't take a bite? You know, if God had put one of these big signs that said, danger, do not touch, I don't know if perhaps that would have been cause enough for them to think about what they were going to do. But God gave all of us amount of freedom. We have less freedom now since the fall, but God gave each one of us the ability to make decisions, good and bad. And so Adam and Eve made a decision, and it fractured, alienated, and developed a sense of separation from God. And notice, the scripture teaches, that they fled because they could hear God coming. And this is very anthropomorphic, but they could hear God's feet in the garden. And God said in a Charlton Heston voice, Adam, where are you? Now, let's remember, God's omnipotent. He knows everything. He knows where we are. He knows what we do. He knows where we live. He knows our name. He even knows, believe it or not, our secret sins, some of the bad things we've done. That's scary. But he knows it, every word we've uttered. But Adam and Eve, in their fallen state, had this sense about maybe you could flee from God. And they began, and there was no sense of fear before the fall, but now anxiety, fear, and discouragement, and fleeting the presence of God became the normal. Now, I've read numerous theologians and scholars on this whole subject of demons and devils and original sin. Do you know that there are many that would disagree with me that in modern scientific age, talk about demons and devils and Satan and all those kind of things and man fallen? Jim, we're living in an age where we can send a satellite off into the universe and see how the universe was formed and shaped. We can take pictures of that. We can go to the moon. We can do heart transplants and all kinds of wonderful things. We're on the verge of curing cancer. What are you talking about, a devil and a demon? Well, I do believe that there's a power and a force that is stronger than any of us. For why do we pray in the Lord's Prayer? Lead us not unto temptation, what? But deliver us from the evil one. The evil one. Peter says he prowls around like a lion waiting to pounce on anyone. And those who do not believe in a devil, like Harvey Cox, who is an American Baptist theologian at Harvard Divinity School, now retired, sad to say he was a Baptist, but anyway, he said, don't leave it to the snake. The snake wasn't the evil one. Really? How do you know to talk with God? How did he have such awareness and such a power over Adam and Eve? I know you can talk about the responsibilities and why all of that happened and why this tree was there, if it was so tempting, what was God all about? God is about trying us to be after his image and likeness, Genesis 1:26. And so our purpose on earth is to express and experience the image and likeness of God everywhere we go. But we're not to be God. We're to be like God. That means the qualities and virtues and characteristics of God. There are things that we can and want to adopt and have our children grow up believing and practicing daily in their lives. So if there is no demon, I've got a problem. How do you explain evil? Evil, how do you explain it? If there's no evil one, why are so many people in Ukraine slaughtered by missiles that hit hospitals and school buildings, soldiers that shoot civilians in the back? How else can I understand nations that build more nuclear weapons? We already have enough, 1,000 times over, to wipe us off the face of the earth, every nation, to destroy the earth, but we need more. Mine's a little bigger than yours. Yours is a little faster than mine. I better get a new one. Isn't that nonsense? Isn't that absurd? No evil one? How do you explain a man that walks into a kindergarten classroom with an assault weapon and brutally, as though he's in a butcher shop, rays across shots and shoots down little innocent 4, 5, and 6-year-olds, splattering their bodies all over the chalkboard? How do you explain that? How do you explain American love affair with guns? We gotta have more guns. We only have 300 million, we might as well get 4 million. 400 million. I'm not opposed to guns. I said that once before from this pulpit. I'm not opposed. I had 6 or 7, but I am opposed against assault weapons. Nobody needs an assault weapon. You don't kill a deer or anything else with an assault weapon. I know some may feel differently. Speak to me after the worship service. Rather speak to Arden, okay? If there is no evil and evil one, how do we explain so much deception and fake news and lies among some of our politicians who struggle to tell the truth, who really don't even know the truth, who have so deceived themselves that they don't know what is right and wrong, and they continue to perpetuate lie after lie after lie? How do you explain that? And how do you explain the way we aggressively, and I want to be careful when I say this, because one time when I said this, a man said to me, well, I wasn't back there in the time of Native Americans. I said, well, you're white, and you're living on what Native American land you used to own, right? He said, yeah, that's true. You should read on the Trail of Tears. Read how we just took the land. We took it. I've been reading a book on the Creek Indians in Alabama, and how white folk just came down and slaughtered them, forced them west. Oh, we got some better land out west for you. Happens to be desert, happens to be you can't grow anything out there, that's why we don't want it. If there is no evil, there is no evil one. How do you explain Americans' original sin of Jim Crow and slavery and racism that continues to rip and reap ugly, raw wounds in our society? As I read the Bible, and I read the Bible, and if I understand this song, Jesus loves the children, all the children of the world, not just white folk, not just red folk, not just black and brown folk, all the children. That includes my sisters and brothers in the African American community. By the way, this is Black History Month. Now I know there's a strong movement. Oh, we don't can't talk about bringing out this bad part of our history. No, we better not bring that out about slavery. And this guy in Florida, I forget his name, he's the governor there. He's banning any books that have bad history in it, except the ones that he thinks is bad and good. Folks, this is a sidebar, let me just say this. The moment people take what you can read, the moment they tell you, you can read this book but not that book, and they're going to take it out of the library, we have lost our democracy, we have lost the freedom of press, we have lost the ability to read what we want to read. Nobody is going to take my books. I'll give them away. So if there is no evil, why is there so much hate? Why are we polluting as we did in East Palestine? Tank cars filled with toxic elements that will linger into the soil and into the water and streams and wells for years to come. And we don't even know yet whether they're carcinogenic. Some are. They're terrible. But this railroad company, which gave the people of East Palestine 6 million, happened to spend 13 billion in stock buybacks. No evil in this country? No Satan? You see, what I think what happens here is, and we're similar to, and our culture is kind of easy to adapt to the fact that we can make our own rules. We can make our own rules. How fast we're gonna go, nobody's gonna tell me what to do. Not even God. So we raised the question before us this morning, as we think about this challenge of what did God say? Think about it. Did God really say you should not commit adultery? Did God really say thou shalt not kill? Did God say you shouldn't steal? Whether you're the government or a corporation or a person, no stealing. Did God say you should have no idols and bear false witness and not tell the truth? Did God say that? Or can I make up my own rules, have my own little Bible, the Jim Olson Bible of faith, and just go by them, abide by them? Is that what God said? Yeah, I think so. He was just suggesting these, right? Or did God mean it? Did God say it? Is God going to help us and hold us accountable? I think the reason our nation and our world is in such degenerative state, with conflicts in Ukraine and around the world, with hunger in parts of Africa, and pollution in all of their oceans and seas, plastic killing whales and porpoises, the reason is we have made our own rules. Nobody's going to tell us how many fish we can catch. On the other hand, did God say, I sent my only son into the world because I love you? Did God say that? Did God say, I'll forgive all of your sins? Did God say that I am going to heal you? that I will raise up out of the dusty, dried bones in the valley of death and raise up these bones to dance. Did God say that? Or is that wishful thinking? I want to take a little parenthetical up, as David would say, a Baptist turn here. Oh, geez. Let me just say, I hope and pray for this congregation, Arden and I do, and think of you folks. We love you dearly. You are a wonderful congregation. But David's absence does not mean that God is not present. Amen? David not here means that God is at work bringing somebody here right this very minute. Do not weary in well-doing. Do not give up. Do not say, well, we got Pastor Olson in the pulpit today. I think I'll stay home. Not David. He can't preach like David. That's true. He'd be dumb by now. No, this is going to be the greatest challenge of this congregation right now. No more splintering, no more schisms, no more debating on what and that and this and that. Work and bond together in love, for God has wonderful days ahead for you. Do you believe that? I do. I believe there's somebody out there. I went through this myself. I pastored for 20-some years in one congregation, and people came up crying. Other people came up and said, Jim, we're glad you're leaving. But no, other people said, what are we going to do without you? I said, you're going to get somebody better. You're going to get somebody who's going to be here. You got to have faith. This isn't easy. This is not easy stuff. This is the most challenging time of this congregation that, since I've been here for 7 years, I've seen. Do not give up hope. Do not abandon God. For I believe, he said, with God, all things are possible. Right? Didn't God say that? I believe he did. I believe he did. So as we come before a close here now, I want to just think about it. Take a deep breath for a second. What are we going to choose? Our own way? Our own words? Or what God said? God's word. How are we going to go? What path? Jesus said the way is narrow and it's wide. You have to choose. Frost said, the road less traveled is the one that's more interesting and more rewarding. As you leave in this first Sunday of Lent, what are you thinking about as we prepare ourselves for all of those wilderness experiences when Jesus comes out of the wilderness and he goes to Jerusalem, he prays over it that they would know for things that make for peace, and then he goes on Maundy, Thursday, as a servant, the Son of God, the one who was there at creation. He was there when the first star and the universe was made. Jesus was there. 1 John chapter 1. All things were created through Jesus, but he walks into his own town and his people don't recognize him. They don't want him. He doesn't wear a big golden crown, and he doesn't have an army with white stallions marching into Rome and marching into Jerusalem on cobble-laden streets. He's got a donkey. This is a tough week and tough month and season for the church, all capital C. Because, you see, it goes from Maundy, Thursday, until the trial early Friday morning, where Pilate gets before him in a philosophical, theological sense and says, what is truth? There's no truth. No truth. And then he puts
Barabbas over here, and he puts Jesus here, and he says to the people, which one are you going to vote for? And the people cry out, Barabbas, and crucify Jesus. What did God say when he was on the cross? Savagely and painfully beaten and mocked, spit upon. Even one of the soldiers, if you're the Son of God, jump down now. What did he say? All right, I'm going to get my AK-47 and my rifle and we'll wipe them all out. No. Father, 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 forgive them, for they know not what they do. I believe that same God who died on the cross, who washed the disciples' feet, who was put into a tomb and on the third day rose up, is saying the same thing, permeating and filling this congregation, this community, this county, this country. Father, forgive them. This is the word of the Lord. Now I want to close, I have to close with a good Baptist story. Are you with me? And this is it, this is really the end of it. How many times have I said that? Two or three? Many. Ugh. Sorry. I want to close with a man I respect very, very much. A man that came out of nowhere, was a farmer, didn't have much money, owned a peanut farm in a small town called Plains, Georgia. You know who I'm talking about? Who told us and showed us how holy living goes on after you have become the most powerful man in the world. I'm sorry. He showed us how to live. He built houses. He went and the guinea worm, and he went over to peace conference. He even offered President Trump, he would go to Korea and North Korea and see if he could bring peace there. Well, right now, Jimmy Carter is teaching us how to die. Holy living and holy dying. Jesus taught us on the cross. Jesus taught us, into thy hands, Father, I commit my spirit fully. But Carter's teaching us right now. And one day, a young man came, it was when Carter was in his, I guess, early 90s, came up and pulled up, it was a Saturday, and the man pulled up along the Plains Baptist Church, and he saw a man out cutting the lawn, the front lawn of the church. The man had a baseball cap, he was pouring sweat, he was hunched over the lawnmower, he had a torn, ripped jean. And the man came over and he said, I understand on Sundays Jimmy Carter teaches Sunday school here. I'd like to be there. Do you know if that's true? Yes. 9 o'clock tomorrow morning, he'll be there. Jimmy Carter never introduced himself to that man until that Sunday morning, but Carter was the one out mowing the grass for that church. And guess where Rosalind was? She had the vacuum cleaner out vacuuming the carpet in the church. Jesus washed their feet. Carter mowed the grass. The least among you shall be the greatest. Go ye and do likewise. That's what God said. Amen.
think you don't have a friend. You got a friend in Jesus. Wow. It's time to pray, and I have some requests here, but I'd like to preface those prayer requests with a couple of prayers. I want to pray for you as a congregation and choir, that God will keep you robust and muscular in faith, that you will not give up, but you'll see with expectation and celebration the best days are yet to come. Sure, there's grief. There's a certain empty spot in their hearts. David is gone. Let's also pray for David. I am still, to this day, 15 years later, getting used to sitting in a pew. It's been hard. I was analyzing that sermon and this, that, and the other thing, and I should be out preaching or teaching or visiting or something. Because God calls you not just for one moment or one day or one month or one year or a decade, but for life he calls you to ministry. So let's pray for David, because indeed he's feeling the same separation and grief that you're feeling. And he's trying to find a place, a home to worship. Let us pray for Jimmy Carter. There's a request here, and I appreciate that request for Jimmy Carter. As I said earlier, the man not only taught us how to live, regardless of his presidency, he's the oldest president, and he and Rosalind have been married 76 years. That's amazing to me. I had weddings where they were married 76 minutes and they left, so. I'm curious, not kidding. What a wonderful example in a world of deceits, politicians lying, and fake elections and all that nonsense. Carter went around the world. I'm preaching again, so I'll stop. Okay, let's pray for Jimmy Carter and thank God for his teaching. And also prayer request for Charles Meyer, who will be at the Dixon Rehab Center for another 3 to 5 weeks. We encourage our church family to visit Charles and let him know we are praying for his healing, peace, and rest. Let me just say that as one who not long ago experienced rehab, cards and calls mean so very much. If you want to send Charles, I don't know his address, but or if you can drop in, say hello, that is part of the healing process. You get your mind off your pain and on to your friend. So let us go to the Lord in prayer. Lord, we come before you, thanking you for every great and good gift you give us, even when we go our own way like sheep who've gone astray. Even when we think we have a better plan or a better way or a better idea of how to worship and how to pray. Or when we go after material things that do not satisfy and are not able to bring contentment. And yet in our hearts we seek more this and that and stuff. When you have fed us with the bread of life, forgive us. I thank you for this congregation. I really do. Lord, and I feel blessed here. We have and still do. There's hospitality here, Lord. There's a welcoming, warm ministry here, Lord. There is opportunity and possibility here, Lord. You have not forsaken these people. You love them. And you pray for them, as Paul tells us, that you intercede for our prayers when we don't even know how to pray. So at this very moment, you're interceding for First Presbyterian Church as they seek for and search for an interim pastor and then a full-time pastor. There's one out there. You have prepared him and her or someone for this very moment and day. But we can go tired and carry around the heavy luggage of, oh, there's only a few people out this morning. We're going to die. We don't have enough money. Lord, may those who dwell in doom and despair be transformed into agents of hope and joy. Lord, we're so thankful for Charles We're grateful that he came through the surgery up in Rockford, and we're grateful that he soon, in a few weeks or so, will be home and able to function fairly normally. In the meantime, may his body be strengthened, his mind be built up and encouraged, and his spirit filled with a sense of expectation that he's going to get well. May we be instruments of that encouragement and peace and joy for Charles. And finally, Lord, we live in a world where there's so many conflicts, there's brutality and evil around the world. And we know that there's evil in our own hearts. We know that, like Cain, we get angry at our brother. Like Joseph's brothers, we're jealous when someone else gets something like a coat of many colors. And like David, we look across the patio down and see this very attractive woman, and we lust not only for sexual ideas and fantasies, but we lust for things of this world, material things, cars, houses, money, bank accounts, things that so-called will build and bring joy when it doesn't, security when it doesn't. Help us to see only you are the bread of life. Only you are the one who is the living water who quenches all of our thirst. We thank you for Jimmy Carter, for indeed he showed us how to live. A servant who knelt down and began to build houses for people who couldn't afford them. He went over into foreign countries and sought to be reconciliation between Arab and Jew. He went to distant lands to see that all elections were held fairly and honestly. And he believed when he took the marriage vow that it wasn't just for a few moments or minutes or decades, but for 76 years and counting. And all the ways that he has demonstrated your love, his servanthood, mowing the church lawn, building furniture for the church and for others, integrating a congregation that refused to welcome blacks as into membership. Thank you for the lessons that he taught us and the challenges that he gives us. And we pray for David, my dear friend. We just pray, Lord, that he finds a home. I know how hard that can be. And I pray, Lord, that he would not take in his heart, I wish I could have done more. I wish I did that. I wish I did that, this. That you would say to him, well done, David, good and faithful servant over those 13 years. Now rest in my joy. Finally, Father, we close knowing that each of us is fragile and delicate. Each of us is vulnerable to a single germ that can destroy our breathing and disrupt our body, making us weak. But we know something else, Lord. We know something very, very true. That even though we go through the valley of the shadow of death, thou art with us. For when the disciples asked, Lord, teach us to pray, you taught them a profound but simple prayer. Our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from the evil one. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen.